Good evening, everyone. My name is Joe Jacoby. I'm the theater instructor here at North Idaho College, and I would like to thank you for coming out tonight and spending your Halloween evening with us. We are very pleased and honored to have Carla Pepperzak, who was born and raised in Amsterdam and has lived all over the world, and became an American citizen in 1958. And lives now in Spokane with her daughter and has very graciously come over to Spokane to speak with us tonight. So I'm going to get out of the way, and I'm very pleased and honored to introduce Carla Pepperzak.
Good evening. I'm glad to see so many people here. That's wonderful. Like you said, I'm Carla Pepperzak. I was born and raised in Amsterdam. And actually, I lived very close to Anne Frank, but I'll talk about that a little later. I had a very nice childhood where everything was fine. And I was until 1940, when the Germans invaded the Netherlands, and I was only 16 years old. I have one sister who is still alive, and my parents, and I went to public school. Now in Amsterdam, there was a rather large Jewish population, and so most of my friends were Jewish, though it was a public school, and there were about 30%, I would say, Jewish kids in the school I attended. I did quite a bit of sports, and one of the sports I did was rowing, and the rowing club I belonged to was actually 95% Jewish, and the very first razzia, which happened in Amsterdam in 1941, was in that rowing club, and about six of my friends were taken, and of course they never did come back. Like I said, I was about 16 years old when the war started, and I had not of course met my husband. We met later after the war. The war started in Holland in 1940. The Germans invaded Poland and Russia and the East in 1939. But in May 1940, there was the invasion. We did not expect it, and though they did fight, and they defended the country for about 5 days, and then it was hopeless. They bombed the city of Rotterdam, but the center of the city was entirely bombed out, and the Queen and the cabinet left in May 15th. The invasion was May 10th, and they went to England. Some people tried to flee also to England, but it was very difficult to do that. The invasion, like I said, was in May 1940, and that happened to be the month I was doing my final exams, and they postponed them a couple of weeks, but I still had to do them. And I remember the bombs falling around us when I did those exams. I was very fortunate. I had decided to go to a private school, a private medical technology school. And because of that, I could continue studying there, because the German decided in 1941-42 to every student in university had to sign a declaration of loyalty to the German government. Most students did not do that, and the result was that they had to close the universities, and the young men who were in that age were sent, many of them were sent to Germany for helping labor for the war effort. Like I said, I hadn't met my husband yet, but he was one of those students. But he was in agriculture, and he went to work for a farm. And because of that, he did not have to go. Later on, they did try to arrest him, But he got himself an asthma attack, and so he was let go again. Later on, again, he was picked up, and then some good German soldiers said, "Get out," when the telephone rang, and he rang it out. He ran through the back door, and he then went into hiding. My husband, by the way, was not Jewish, but he had to go into hiding anyhow, because you did not, any young man in Holland was sent to the labor camp, so you didn't see any young men on the streets. Like I said, there was 5 days of fighting. Then the German government, and they installed almost immediately a civil government. However, the head of the government was a general, Seyss Inquart, an army general. He, in the beginning, he said, everything should be normal. We don't have any changes. We just let things, just do the things you're normally doing. And indeed, there was not all that much of a change in the first 6 months. But Amsterdam and the Netherlands always has been very open and society, so they allowed a lot of people to be coming in from other places. Like actually in the 1500s there was the Inquisition in Spain and Portugal, and a lot of Jewish people who were told either to convert or to or they would be killed, they fled to the northern parts, and a lot of them fled to Amsterdam. So Amsterdam had a large Jewish population. Actually, before the war, in all of the Netherlands were 180,000 Jewish people. In Amsterdam, about 70,000. After the war, in total, there was 20,000 left. Percentage-wise, most of the Jewish people in the Netherlands, the highest percentage, it was murdered and killed. Like I said, life was in the beginning not too much of a change. And I also mentioned that it was an open society, so when you register as a child or anything, nobody needed to register what the religion was. And that made it very hard for the Germans, because they didn't know who was Jewish and who wasn't Jewish. So they made all the Jewish people register, and this was in about 9 months after they had come in 1941. Some did not, and they were lucky, but most people didn't think too much about it, and they said, okay, they registered themselves. And slowly but surely, they started to make life for Jewish people difficult. All the civil servants, all the people working in government were dismissed. All the university professors who were Jewish were let go. They were not allowed to teach anymore. So that was the first indication that it wasn't going to be simple. It wasn't, that they were not going to do anything. And like I said, there was an open society in Holland, and there were no ghettos. The Dutch themselves, the Jewish Dutch people felt first Dutch and then Jewish. That was a religion, but even though some of them were not very religious, many were not very religious. But the, like I said, I'm sorry, I got myself confused. They felt so much part of the Dutch society that there was really no difference here. And the Dutch people accepted everybody who was there. And it didn't matter if it were different people. However, and so there were about 21,000 Jewish businesses, owned by Jewish business people. They had to register too. Then they were told, no, it's better that you sell it, or that you can discount, I'm sorry, I can't think of the word. That anyhow, either the Germans took it over later on, or you had to sell it, or you close the doors. And my father had his own, he manufactured clothes, and he sold his business to actually, my mother was not Jewish, and he sold his business to the brother of my mother, though he kept on doing it. So that for a while that went well until they had to close the doors. Because my everybody had to register, about 6 months later, everybody in Holland, Jews or no Jews, had to get an identification card. And the Jewish people had an identification card with a J on it. And I have here the original ID cards. Let's show. I think he can pull. I don't know where he's going to. Oh, sorry. Can you see it? This is an ID card. Now, the Jewish people had a J behind next to the picture. And I had one like that, but because of my mother not being Jewish, born and raised, my father went to an attorney and got me a other ID card. And so this is my ID card, and this is without a J on it. I have one here for my husband. But he was not Jewish. Like I said, he did not have to have. Now, all the Jewish people had by this time, after the IDs came in, they had to wear a star. This is, by the way, an original star. This is the Dutch word for Jewish Jode, they call it. Can you see it? Huh? Okay, you may hold it up.
Lower.
Oh, lower. Okay. Sorry, I can't see what I'm doing. Those cards are important because what happened really, because of the fact that I did not have to have a J and then I did not have to wear a star, I became involved with helping people and helping my relatives to start with. An uncle of mine asked me to start at first to, if I could help to find a hiding place, because in 1942 they really started to pick up Jews and take them to the trains, and to, there was actually a transfer camp in Holland too, where they took them first and then onto the German or Polish or Austrian camps. So people who could would go into hiding, and they asked me, because I could walk around, my uncle asked me if I could help him, and I did knew of somebody who in the underground. The underground or the resistance movement started almost immediately when the invasion took place in the beginning of May, in May 1940, and they did blow up bridges and, you know, made the signs on the road where they turned them around so they get people went in the wrong directions, or the German army in the wrong directions. And so they did all kind of things to thwart the German war effort. But they also helped, for instance, if an airplane would fly over and was shot down, the pilot, and we helped them to go into hiding. Anyhow, because of the fact that my uncle asked me to help him, I did so, and I got in touch with the underground resistance movement, and I became part of that. And one of the first things we did, number one, was to find a home for the people, of course. But number two was to get them a new identification card without the J on it. But they had given me, the underground, a little machine that was about this size to make the fingerprints. And I asked the people to bring a little picture, of course. We tried to give them a different name, not if they had a real Jewish name, but try to keep the same initial, So if they had a ring or something with initials on, they could keep that. And also for signing papers or whatever, it was much better to keep the same initial on, you know, on the ID card. So that was one of the jobs we did, the first thing. And then when people went into hiding, we had to work very carefully. They never could go into with the whole family. They went one by one. Now, by this time also, this is in 1942 when it really started to get bad. The Jewish people were not allowed to go on a bus or a streetcar or a train. But by the time, if I got them a new card, and then we made sure that the star was off the coats, because you never wore a star inside, you only wore a star outside on the coat, on your jacket or a coat or something. So if they were not looking too Jewish, I would go with them, go in the streetcar, or go on the bus, or go on the train, and to the hiding place. Once they were in a hiding place, the difficulty, of course, was then to get food and to take care of them. No, nobody who offered, the host and hostess who usually offered a hiding place, had no inkling that this would be about 3 years. This was 1942, and Anne Frank went also in 1942, but it was up to 1945 that they had to stay in hiding. Now, I could help about 24 to 26 people. I never really counted them to go into hiding. Unfortunately, the ones I helped, nobody got caught. They all got back safe and sound, which was very fortunate. Like I mentioned, the first razzia was in 1941. And then also there was a strike in the city of Amsterdam because the local population was very upset that the Dutch people, that the Jewish people were picked up. And because there was really, there were no bad feelings between Jewish people and other people. There was very little anti-Semitism at the time. Became part of the resistance. I did other things too, but one of the things is, like I mentioned, the people had to be fed, and there were rationing cards. And the rationing cards, I have one here. I don't see it now. They were like this. This is also an original one. I don't know if I see it. And on those, you got a weekly card. So we had to make sure that those people who went into hiding got those cards. So what we did, and I was part of it once in a while, raid rationing cards centers and stole them from the car, and used those. Other ones were printed in England, like the ID cards, by the way, they were also printed in England. And they were dropped at night by small planes, and through the radio we knew where the plane would land or where they would drop things, and we would pick them up and could use them that way. So this was one of the ways to make sure that the people got their new IDs. And then also when the people were in hiding, not only that they had to have the food, and that they had, sometimes they needed medicine, sometimes they needed whatever they needed, and I would visit them once in so many weeks and would bring them the rationing cards, but also would, if they needed medicine, then I could get it. I was studying medical technology, like I mentioned. I was at a private school. I wasn't there very often. I missed some exams because I was always busy with this resistance movement, because of that, I could get sometimes medication, and I had a contact in a hospital. I also, because of that, I was given a German nurse's uniform, which I used only when it really was needed. And one time I used it, I had an aunt who had 5 kids, her husband, and they lived in Rotterdam, and her husband had already been picked up and sent to Germany to camp. And she and the 5 kids were sent to the transfer camp in Holland. But the train was going to stop in Amsterdam. And a neighbor of hers called me and said that she was on the train. And I went to the train and found her and asked if I could take the youngest. The youngest boy was 2.5 years old at the time. And she said, okay. So I had my nurse's uniform on. I also had some fake German Ausweises, as we call them, and I have some here. I was stopped by a German soldier, but I showed him my Ausweis, or here it is, and my uniform. I had my nurse's uniform on, they said, "What about the little boy?" I said, "Well, he's very ill. I have to take care of him. He's my son," and so they let me go. He lived through the war. The poor fellow. My parents could not take him. By the way, this is the paperwork I carried with me when I had this uniform on. My parents couldn't take him, of course. And he went from different houses. He was in 3 or 4 different places. After the war, my parents did take him in, because his parents, of course, never did come back. And the poor fellow was light and wouldn't want to go to school. He had, he was really mixed up. And my parents had a very difficult time with him. He did end up being actually an artist, and though my father supported him in the rest of his life, so it was not a happy situation. But the poor fellow, lived, but his beginning years were very difficult. Another time I had an interesting thing happening, a good friend of mine, whose husband already had been sent to Germany, was pregnant, and she was ready to get a baby, and she went to a very small little hospital, private hospital, to get this baby. While she was in the hospital, the SS came to pick her up and her son. She had an 8 years old boy. And the neighbors told them, oh, she's in the hospital, and they also told them which hospital it was. But they were, fortunately, they did call the hospital and warned her hospital that the SS was on its way to pick her up. She decided to leave, she left her baby at the hospital call because she didn't think they were going to take this 2 days old baby. Well, they did. They did take the baby. And she went into hiding, and she asked me if I could get the baby back for her. I tried all kinds of things, but there was no way of doing it. Now, the baby was sent to this transfer camp, what we called Westerbork, and it happened to be that an uncle of mine, a brother of my father, was working in that hospital. He did not want to go into hiding. I had tried to get him into hiding, and he said, no, it's God's will, we do what we need. We do. Anyhow, but he was working in that hospital, in the transfer camp, and he heard somehow that I was trying to get this baby freed, and he sent me a message through the underground again to make sure that I would keep my hands up, because they really were anxious to get the woman, the mother. Well, the mother, after a couple of weeks, decided to give herself up, and she went to that camp and was reunited with the baby. She did take her 9 years old boy. And fortunately, they came back. That was amazing. She lived through this, and she came back after the war with the 2 children, except she was very ill and had cancer and died about a couple of months later after she was returned to Holland. Another thing with the people in hiding was that, like I said, we took care of their food, or we tried to take care of the food. The people had to, the host and hostesses always had to go out and buy stuff for them, but could never buy in large amounts, even in small amounts. But so they, most of the people in hiding had saved some money to pay for all this. And at the time, they had guilders, and they were large denominations, like 1,000 guilders, which was the easiest to save because it's, you know, just doesn't take much room. And then the German government decided, I think it was in 1943, to not allow those 1,000 guilders anymore. And everybody had to could turn it into the bank and got smaller denominations. So the people in hiding asked me to go and exchange this. And I was, number one, I was too young. And number two, there was no way I could go with a lot of money to a bank and exchange it. So I asked some people in the underground who know who had to do with it, could do this, to do this, and they did. And I was lucky to get 50 to 60% on the money. And one couple or one man, and they came back after the war, tried to sue me for the rest of the money. He saw that I had kept that money, but of course I hadn't kept a penny of it. But anyhow, that's it was one of those things which happened. Anne Frank. Anne Frank lived, we lived about a block away from where she lived. I can give you the name of the street. She lived on Merwee de Plein, number 38, and we lived north of Amsterdam. It was in a river neighborhood. In Amsterdam, you had neighborhoods which they named after rivers or flowers or musicians or artists, and this was the river neighborhood. And it turned out that her sister is Margot, and she went to the same temple, and there was a Reformed temple as I did, actually, in the temple. But we had Hebrew lessons at the rabbi's home, Rabbi Mailer. And so that's, I got to meet Margot, saying Dutch Margot, in England, English Margot. Her sister, the sister was about 2.5 years younger than I was. Anne was about 6 years younger than I was. So, you know, when you're 16 years old, you have very little to do with a 10 years old. But I have been in the house. I'm probably the only one alive at the moment who was in the house, in their apartment. And I remember so well they had this big, heavy German furniture, and it really wasn't fitting in very well. It was too big for the place, but those things happened. And Margot and me were in the same stage. We were on a stage play and on a Purim play. And so we also went to the same stores, and but I didn't have much contact with Anne, but I knew her, and I definitely knew her sister better. She did not go to the same school as I did. Well, she went to a Montessori school. And actually, I have an interesting picture here. I don't know if you can see this. This is, how do I show that here, this way? This is, Anne is, no, it's hard to see. Anne is here. This is very interesting. A friend of mine was recently, about a year ago, on a cruise ship, and heard a couple speaking Dutch, and she said, well, you know, she said, this is an American friend, and she said, I have a friend from Holland. They got to talk. It turned out that the fellow she met he and his wife lived in Florida, and his brother was in the same classroom as Anne Frank. And this picture he had hanging in his room in Florida, in Sarasota, Florida. And he sent me this he took a picture of it, and he sent this by email to me. So this picture I really got from her, which is, it's hard to see, but we could pass it around if you want to. I have an extra one. Anyhow, I think Anne's importance was, number one, she was of course very young, but her writing, It's so interesting. There are so many books written on the Holocaust, and the people read them, but I think the one and her and Frank's diary made probably the most impression, not only on adults but especially on younger children. Her insight in life as such and her understanding was amazing. And I think it's a very important thing that we keep on having this play, but also read her diary and understand what it all meant. Because we have a group in what we call in Spokane Yom HaShoah Committee, and I'm on that Yom HaShoah Committee. Yom HaShoah means the day of the Holocaust, the day of reckoning. And the important thing is that never again, the hate should, you know, it's amazing how many people still hate, and hopefully that, and Frank explained, hate is so useless, and it is useless. And like I said, we celebrate once a year in Spokane the day of the Holocaust, and that is in April, actually this year, I think, and this coming year is April the 26th on a Sunday, and everybody's welcome. But we call this committee the Yom HaShoah Committee, but also say never again. This is our email address, it's so important that we, try to get along with each other, and that we don't have that hate. And we're here, and I don't know, especially we have right near the campus here is this office from the Human Rights Committee, and they tried to, of course, they were formed after the Nazi tried to form this group, or had the group in Hayden Lake here, or Hayden, Idaho, and they are trying to help people not to hate. My point is always, if you don't like something, or you are very upset about something, or you hate something, write it down. And if you write it down, you get it out of your system and you see it, and it makes so much difference. So I tell the young people when I talk to them in schools that please write down things, and maybe that will help you, get over your difficulties of hating. I think that is the main thing I want to talk about, and I'm open for questions if anybody has any questions. Don't see any.
What brought you to the United States?
Oh, my husband. I met him after the war, and like I said, he never did have to go to the German war. But he studied international tropical agriculture, and he got a scholarship through the Institute of International Education. He got his engineering degree in Holland, an agriculture engineering degree. Then he got the scholarship, and we sent him to Iowa, though he studied tropical agriculture. We always were a little surprised about it, but it was a good agriculture school. And we married because it was much easier to follow him if you were married than if you were just engaged. So we married, and then we came to the States, and then he was born originally in Indonesia. Interesting for my family, I'm the only one born in Amsterdam. My husband was born in Indonesia. My daughter Marion here was born in Liberia, West Africa. My son was born in West Africa, and two other daughters who were born in Iowa. So I'm the only one who, we became U.S. citizens, like I said, in 1958 in Hawaii, when it was still a territory. And actually, we were there when Hawaii got its statehood in March 59. So, did that answer your question?
I've got a microphone here, so if anybody has any questions, there's any questions, then I'll come to you, okay?
Thank you for taking the time to come share this with us. It's very important. You mentioned earlier in your talk that the Jews, when they were asked to submit, to register rather, you know, by the acting government, that I got the impression that many or most of them did so.
Yes.
And my question to you is, why would they do that? And do you also have any comments on, you know, today's government, what trust level we should have?
The last question, last part of the question, today's government? Well, let me answer the first registration. Like I said, the Germans, when they came in, they swore, they had information out that they would not do to the Jewish people as what they had done in Germany. So people trusted them, which was, of course, the biggest mistake they could have made. And that's why they registered. And to tell you the truth, I don't know. I'm awfully glad that some of them didn't, but and I don't know what the reasoning from some of those people were to register, because it was a stupid thing to do, but they didn't know that. They really thought that nothing like that would happen in Holland, what happened in Germany. And they really believed that. So that was the reason. And I didn't further.
And so should we trust today's government?
Wow. I don't know. I think we have to be very careful. And we really have to make sure that we understand what it's all about and make up our own minds. And don't listen and don't follow everything what they tell. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Could you address what it felt like to try to rebuild after the war with thousands of your friends and neighbors gone?
Yeah, that was interesting to say. I should have brought it out, because I was awfully glad to leave Holland. Now, there were only 20,000 Jewish people left. A lot of businesses were gone. My father was, fortunately, he got through this. The banks came to him to offer him money for loans so he could start over again. And this happened to other people. Those who had good businesses before the war, banks came to them and offered money so they could start in again. It was a very slow process, of course, because there wasn't much. After the war, there was very little food. The farms were not working. It all took quite some time before things came back to normal. Trains were not running. The part of the Holland was flooded. The Germans made. This is a map of Holland. This part was all flooded, and because of that, all the farms were gone. And it was a long, long process, difficult, but people were so happy that they were free again that they would accept anything and do anything, and worked hard for it. There was a question in the back there. Oh.
You already gave your opinion about the Diary of Anne Frank. What's your opinion about the book, The Hiding Place?
You know, actually, originally, the book von Anne Frank was called The Hiding Place in Dutch. But so I don't know. Are there two books now? Are we talking about two different books?
Yeah, it's by Terry.
Then I haven't even read that.
Yes, you have.
I have?
Yeah.
So
it's Terry Tenboom.
Oh.
Corey Tenboom.
Oh, Corey Tenboom. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about another book written by Anne Frank. That whole family, you know, she lived through it, right? But the rest of the family was killed. It was a very powerful book, I think. Yeah, I have that book. I'm sorry, I didn't realize it. I should mention about a book something, and I don't know if you can get this on here. This says Jewish Amsterdam. This book was published in the 80s, I think in 88 or something. My brother-in-law, this happens to be his sister's wedding. His sister and her husband and his parents were taken away. Everything in the house was taken away later on. There were no pictures left. Now, imagine my brother-in-law walking in Amsterdam and past the bookstore and sees this book in the window. And he absolutely, he was so upset because, number one, you know, he did not know that any of these pictures were left. And number two, they never even contacted him for anything. So it turns out that apparently somebody must have taken those pictures from their home and saved them. And when they started publishing this book, they used the pictures. Inside there are some more of them and of the family. He was absolutely, totally unaware of that. And he contacted the publisher, the writer, and told them how upset he was, and they ignored him, sort of. But my brother-in-law, by the way, like I said, he lost his only sister and his parents. He fled. He left Holland. He walked part of the way. He went by train to ended up in Spain, got a ship, ended up in Cuba. From Cuba, he went to New York. In New York, he decided to join the Dutch division of the Canadian Army. And so he went to Canada, and from Canada, he was sent to London, and he was working in the army in London on airplanes. And so he came back to Holland. He made the rounds, but after the war, he came back to Holland. Quite a few other people did that. Those who fled went back in the Dutch army and were sent to England. The bombing raids in Holland, in Amsterdam especially, the navigator was often a Dutchman from that area. So they knew exactly where to bomb, so they were trying not to, you know, to do the wrong places and So that really was a wonderful system they had, that they used the Dutch navigators. I was mentioning that the underground also helped the pilots which were shot down. One young man, and I got to know him a little bit, was picked up by the Germans because he was chewing gum. Now, there was no gum in Holland. And by chewing gum, the soldier said, "How did you get that gum?" And then he was taken away and shot right there and there. So interesting things happened, to say the least. So any more questions? I don't know what time it is, but still.
Hi. You know, I've read a lot of books about that were written by survivors of the Holocaust. And one book in particular was written by a girl that talked about all the orphans,
yes,
from the Holocaust. And they had made their way up to Holland, and then they were transported as a unit, all these
children. The
Kindertransport,
are you talking about?
Yes, yes.
They went on to England.
Yep. And, this group in particular went to Israel. And they were on a ship, and as they came into Israel, there were, I think, 1,000 children on the ship, and all of these English soldiers started shooting at these children, and the kids were jumping off the boat, and it was a horrible massacre of these children. And so my question is, what, you know, how were the British towards the Jews? And
well, it was the law or whatever. They had made a decision not to have any Jewish people going to Israel. At the time, it was called Palestine, and so they really were sort of following orders, But the British, there were, of course, a large group of anti-Semitic people. I mean, that soldiers can shoot on kids is unbelievable. And, you know, I think there was part of it on Cyprus, too. They sent them finally to Cyprus. But some awful things happened. It's just unbelievable that it's a true story. I know that it happened. Now, there were other kinder transport who were sent to England, and they were fortunately lived through this. I don't know how many kids were killed at the time, but it was just awful. I think some of the British did it because they liked to do it, and other ones did it to follow orders. But they should never have killed them. They should have returned them or sent them somewhere else. And they didn't do it. There was anti-Semitism all over the world, I'm afraid to say. And even in the States, our government at the time, they were warned. Some of them, there were warnings going to them, and that they didn't believe it, or they felt they couldn't do anything. And so they could have saved many more people if they really had wanted to, and they didn't.
This is a little off topic, but this is really amazing because I'm actually really seeing a real life survivor that lived during the Holocaust, and I was wondering if you could sign my paper.
It's fine, I will sign the paper. Yeah. Are you a student? Somewhere I should
say.
Now, I mentioned briefly that once a year in Spokane we have the Holocaust memorial service. What we do is we send to every middle school and high school, and we try to get as many schools involved as possible. The students are asked to write an essay, and we have three winners usually for middle school and three winners for high school, and the winner. The top winner gets $500 scholarship for the high school. I think the middle schools get a $300 scholarship. This is usually by the end of December, and the essays are due in March. This year, we were talking about kinder transport. We don't exactly know yet what the the subject will be, but it will have to do with children and the reaction to what happened in the war, what happened in the Holocaust. So those who have young people and who have middle school and high schoolers, beware that we will contact the teachers, and hopefully they can take part in writing an essay. And we read every essay which comes in, and then decide on who will be the winner. Thank you. And then the winner will, the Spokane Review publishes the essay, and it also will be, the winner will be giving it at at a memorial service. And this is at Temple Beth Shalom in Spokane on South Hill. So and that's in April. So, and if you know of anybody who would be interested, let them talk to the high school, the social teacher, either the English teacher or history teacher. We will contact them all, though, and let them know that this possibility is open. It's one very good way of the youngsters getting to learn about the Holocaust, because we want them to do the research. We also give them some sites to look at. The Holocaust Museum in Washington has a lot of information, and has an extensive library where the young people can do the research on. Because the whole idea is that people know about this and that it doesn't happen again, like I say, never again. So, I don't know any more.
Hi, I think you're an amazing woman. I'm right here. Oh. I just wanted to say my dad was in the Holocaust, and he was in France. And he had to climb the Pyrenees Mountains to get to Spain. And when he got to Spain, they didn't have papers, so they all were in a camp. They all the Nazis came and put him in a camp for a year. So I'm a miracle to be here, too.
Yeah, second generation.
Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to say, were you scared when
all
that was happening?
All the time.
Was it just...
You were scared all the time, because anything you did, I had to go with this little machine to make those false papers, and you carried it, but yeah, I was always scared. And it was an enormous relief when it was all over. It's very hard to explain the relief, but you feel that and it was 5 years of it. Interesting enough, somebody asked me, how do you keep going? I was always very convinced that the Germans would not win, that the regime could not continue. And so I had always was full of hope. And I think hope is a very important thing to have for everybody. It doesn't matter, it wasn't in those years, but I think if you can hope for the future, if you can hope that things get better, then it's easier to get through.
So one more question. If that ever were to happen again, and we had to register as Jews, what would you say?
Don't register.
Thank you.
Very simple.
I just wanted to start by saying thank you for coming. It's amazing.
You're welcome.
My great-grandfather was in a concentration camp and went through that. And I was wondering, what was it like when the Allies came and started helping? What happened?
You know, of course, I was not in camp, so that makes a big difference. In Holland, the interesting thing is what happened. The Normandy invasion was in June 44, and they went all the way up to the big rivers in Holland, and they never made it north of the rivers. It's interesting. And we were really ready for them to come. The rivers are here, and this part was free, and this part was still under German occupation. And that was the winter that... what they call the hunger winter. People, it was the winter from 1944, 45. People died because they didn't have enough food. There was no electricity, there was nothing. We ate sugar beets or whatever there was. My mother had some beans, which were took hours and hours because she had nothing to cook it on. So they used charcoal from between the railroad tracks and a little tin can. And then they made some little fire, and it was. And then we were liberated finally in May. Well, the Germans gave up in May 45, and that's when we had the Canadian Army came into Holland. Not the German Army, but the Canadian Army, and so that was just wonderful. Everybody, you know, loved it. I have pictures from people just being so happy to see the soldiers. Excuse me. So, any more questions, or Lani?
Yeah. When it came down to making the decision to stay and fight or flee, what made you decide to stay and fight?
It was sort of automatically. Excuse me. You know, since I was asked to help, you sort of rolled into it. It was not a conscious decision. It was just that I felt I could do it, so I better do it. Maybe it's part guilt feeling that I was so lucky that I did not have to wear that star, and that I could help it. It's just, I think it's a human thing to try to help each other, and that's the way it was with me. I really was very grateful that I could help. So there was never a decision to be made. It went just sort of automatic. Never sort of fleeing. Excuse me.
Since you knew Margot and Anne, after it was all over, did you ever meet their father again?
No.
No.
I left Holland in 1940, very beginning of 1948. We never met. I had met him before, but I did not meet him afterwards. He was, I think he was for a time in Switzerland. He didn't get to Holland until later. Excuse me. So,
Carla?
Yes.
You've been here about an hour. How are you doing? If you are ready to continue,
No, I think we probably should.
Pardon?
Because of my coughing, unless there's any more questions.
We do have one more question. We'll
okay,
have to finish
yes.
fairly soon.
Yeah,
but,
okay.
I wanted to see how you're doing.
Yeah, at 7:30.
At age 16, you chose to join the resistance movement. Mm-hmm. Did you know any of your other peers who chose the opposite direction and bought into the Nazi ideals?
Actually, no, because most of my friends were Jewish, and so there was, but I knew some store owners and some, but not none of my peers I know that. That I knew joined the Nazi movement. I had a cousin who became very high up in the resistance. He was some kind of a top. They didn't give him any name. They had just names. This is another interesting thing. We all had different names, or just only used the first names. So we never knew who was who, in case you were caught. So you didn't. But no, I didn't. Thank you. Excuse me. So I think we better.
Yeah. I'd like to say thank you to Carla for joining us tonight. This has been even more wonderful than I thought it would be.
Awesome.
Thank you so much.
I'm sorry. Thank you.